Bruce DuMont back in Chicago. We've got some callers on the line. Let's go to Ryan listening to us in Roselle, Illinois. Go ahead. You're on the air, Ryan.
Hello, it's Brian, actually.
Yeah, that's what I said.
Okay. You know, in the whole illegal immigration conversation, both parties playing game issues can't get anything because the Chamber of Commerce Republicans like cheap labor, mm-hmm. and they will never shut it off.
That's true.
And then the Democrats, they're only in building a voting block. Just like the blacks think they can lock down the Hispanics, and that's the road to permanent power in the future. Mm-hmm. And in the meantime, they're selling out his working class. And that's the long and the short of the issue. And I predict that if Democrats on this, when they say they're not open borders, but if you add up all their positions, spells open borders, and this idea of giving illegal immigrants automatic free health care, Donald Trump will win 2020. There's no doubt.
Mm-hmm. I want to, Brian, hang on a second, because I want to let Don Rose tell some historical stories, if you will, because in the introduction in the last hour, I mentioned that Don Rose, over the years, he's worked for Republicans, and he has worked for Democrats, mostly progressive Democrats, but he's worked for Republicans in a variety of offices. When they've been more liberal than the Democrats. But again, Don, and stop me if I'm wrong here, one of the key things that has always concerned you is vote fraud.
Yep.
And vote fraud was, and I guess to some extent maybe still is, but not as much as it was 20, 30 years ago, vote fraud is an important part of how the Democratic Party in Chicago and Cook County and the city of Chicago maintained its power over minority voters.
Absolutely.
And so tell us, I mean, because you've been exercised about it for 50 years, when you hear the debates now about making elections fair and square, it's generally the Democrats on the national scene that are viewed as trying to make the elections more fair and more square by coming up with their new, their plans. But I go back historically. That's not been the experience that I've had in the state of Illinois, and I don't think you have either.
Well, that's true. There's no question that the party in power, which was the Democrats, stayed in power using vote fraud quite frequently. Many, many different techniques depending on what the methodology was of the voting, whether it was a paper ballot or the old machine, various voting machines and so on. And progressive independent Democrats of my stripe have fought this over the years. This is why we had an independent political movement in Chicago that's, elected aldermen and various, a couple of congressmen over the years, mm-hmm. and so on, fighting against vote fraud. And we took the lead in this. I think it was independent Democrats that took the lead in trying to staunch vote fraud, forming with the Republicans Project LEAP, League of Elections in All Precincts, mm-hmm. which was able to put independent precinct independent judges in to fill vacancies.
But in moving to a contemporary discussion of vote fraud, do you believe that one party, either the Republicans or Democrats now, are deliberately trying to create rules for elections that are detrimental to society? In other words, they're trying to diminish a voting bloc from showing up at the polls.
Yes, and I believe that nationally, that is the Republican Party. Not in every state, but if you look at where it's happening, you go back to the states, that begin with the slave states, which are seeking new and, you know, continue to seek new and better ways to stop the voting of minorities.
So, Don, how does motor voter laws, same-day registration, no requirements for IDs, all of which are bedrock democratic principles, how do those not create an environment in which voter fraud can exist? Please explain
that
to me.
And the question, for example, of same-day registration was one that we opposed here in Chicago at one point when the machine was going to be probably manipulating that.
But you're saying that Republicans alone are the ones that are trying to disenfranchise
people.
Not
alone, but the Republicans more for the largest voter suppression movements. And we can't...
But cleaning off voter rolls for people who are dead and who should not be able to vote, those are things that Republicans are doing in order to try to preserve the integrity of the process.
They're not cleaning them up legitimately. They are tossing more people off. Not in every instance. You're going to find somewhere, some town where it's been done right. But as we look at what's happened in Florida, when we look at what's happened in Georgia, when we look at what's happened in Kansas, it has been a prejudicial wiping of off of the rolls.
So African Americans and Asians and Latinos are being removed from the voter rolls. Republicans are identifying who these individuals are, and they're taking them out based on their racial status, their identity. Is that what you're saying? Because I've heard it claimed that it's because of the voter ID, that, you know, that not all minorities have a driver's license, so they can't vote. And so, therefore, it's racial somehow.
That is a racist construct, actually.
Right,
too.
I've heard that used, but I haven't heard that in Florida. I know Stacey Abrams thinks that 25,000 African Americans were disenfranchised. She's claiming that because they were actually, people went in and pulled the names off the voter rolls? Is that... I don't understand how they were removed. You're saying they were removed from the voter rolls. They were removed based on race?
In Georgia, they were done in the office of the Secretary of State.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Okay,
yes,
then why really. So this was proven, and so why was nobody... I guess I find this mind-blowing that... I mean, what a charge that based on race, some Republican racist came through and actually threw people off the voter rolls. I didn't know that. I mean, this is a...
That's what she has alleged.
She has alleged, and...
But you believe that, too. Is this
yes,
a widespread...
I do.
Okay, that's a stunning... She's a loser in a race. I can see where she might come up with this kind of thing. You know, like, oh, I was, you know...
The Secretary of State.
Sure, I understand that. But, you know, in Florida, we're talking... You're alleging this happened in Florida as well. Of course, we saw what happened with the Democrat in Broward County and what she was doing. So I guess and the Democrats bristled heavily when racial accusations were made against her. So I just find this whole conversation just incredible. Again, it always comes down to race, and I just find it to be the laziest argument around, and it's really very offensive.
When we come back, we're
well, race is what it's all about in this country still, and you ought to know it.
I do not know it, actually.
Tough.
Back shortly from Chicago. Back in Chicago, and we're having quite a spirited conversation during the break. And Nick, you've made the point that there's all kinds of ways in which people who should not be voting are voting, and Don is making the point that there are people who should be able to vote and they're being kicked off rolls by
well, Don made the curious point that years ago it was a Democrat-led effort to instigate voter fraud, but now somehow it's magically now moved to be just Republicans. You've got harvesting of votes in California. You've got motor
vote. What is harvesting of votes?
Harvesting means if you vote and you vote and you vote, I can come to your houses, collect your votes, and submit them on your behalf. That's harvesting of votes. That is occurring in California, and there is a movement to have it spread to other states. It is rife for fraud. So is automatically registering people to vote, whether or not they choose to do that or not. I want everybody who should be able to vote to vote, and I want nobody who shouldn't be able to vote to vote.
I agree with you.
That's the point. But it's ridiculous to suggest that this is only the Republicans who are
it's
now doing this.
Not only the Republicans, but the Republicans are doing it in massive numbers in the South and some border states.
If you
this could be solved
wanna,
easily.
If you want to drive a car, you need a driver's license.
Mm-hmm.
That is a form of identity or ID. Now, if you do not drive a driver's license, you can go to the Secretary of State, at least in Illinois, I would assume in many other states. You can get a state ID. It's not a driver's license, but it identifies you for being who you are. What's wrong with mandating that when you go to vote, you have to have one of those two forms of identity?
Ask the Democrats.
It seems simple, Don.
You are changing the game. Why didn't we do that in the first place?
We should have.
Because you need to clean up the fraud.
But my question is, what's wrong with doing that now? If everybody can agree, I'm not so sure you can do it, but a lot of people would like to have every vote count and make sure that everyone who is eligible to vote should vote.
Right.
I'm supportive of that. I just want to make sure that the person that walks into the polls is the person who say they are. And a way to do that is if you have a photo ID, I mean, you need it to cash a check, you need it to get on an airplane, why do you not need it to vote?
Because people should have access to voting more than they should to airplanes or checking accounts.
Access to voting. The access to voting is you have to have, there's a requirement. You don't have to pay for it. There's a requirement if you want to vote in the United States.
You have to have
a driver's license or some form of ID. What's wrong with that?
When people
who argue against it, seems to me, are arguing in favor of illegality and making it easy for people who aren't citizens or aren't legal voting.
I would buy your argument if, upon registration, you had to present something. But we have registered voters who, for various reasons, sometimes financial, cannot get to the right place to get either a driver's license or, as I carry, a state identification card. We changed the rules. If this was a rule for voter registration when you first registered in the South, in South Chicago, in New York, California, wherever, okay. But we changed the game. When we found out, a certain party found out that a lot of African Americans who tend to vote Democratic and Latinos who tend to vote Democratic didn't have all of these kinds of documents.
Here's my point. Why do we have to make excuses to lower the standard of voting? Because some people are too lazy to figure out how it's done. I mean, there's got to be
lazy, buddy.
Let me finish. Hey, okay. You know what I mean? There's all kinds of people that look for the easiest way out. And what I'm saying is, by lowering the standard, do we change the standard for all and raise the question of whether or not our elections are legitimate?
Now you're bordering on wanting literacy tests.
I don't want a literacy test. But I want someone who's voting to understand. And by the way, there's all I have no problem with political parties or whoever the case may be, or librarians or the police department, whatever. I have no problem if a person can go to some form of authority and get an ID.
Right.
I've got no problem. They shouldn't be charged for it. It could be 365 days a year. I want to make it easy for them to get an ID, and that ID is their ticket to vote and select the elected leaders of the country.
And not only that, you have governmental entities at the local, county, municipal, state levels that exist specifically to serve the population, plus tens of thousands of advocacy groups who all, if they wanted to do what you just described, Bruce, could make sure that every U.S. citizen in this country is registered to vote, which would be just fine with me. And then with the proper ID, and then only people who are alive would vote. Only people would only be able to vote once.
Right.
And then the process would have integrity. But the canard that keeps coming up about Russian interference and all that as the big issue, no, the big issue is within our borders, people voting who should not be voting.
And it's so disingenuous, because I'd like to know, then they keep saying this policy.
Where have you documented this?
I just gave you all of the circumstances. You can't.
You've given me circumstances.
No, Don, you haven't given one
same
reason.
Same baloney that Trump came up with.
Harvest.
About why he didn't.
Bruce just came up with a very simple solution, yeah, which I added to. You don't have a single good reason why that isn't a sensible approach.
I think it's a sensible approach, but I think we've got to give a lot of help. And
fine.
He's saying that we can do a lot of help.
Governmental entities, advocacy groups. Yeah. Everybody can do it. Make sure that everybody has an ID. If somebody moves from Illinois to another state and they are registered here, who moves? Tell me one person in this room who knows somebody who moved from one state to another and called back to their former state and said, please take me off the voter rolls.
Right.
There's nothing stopping somebody from going, okay, I'm going to vote in Illinois and I'm going to vote in Tennessee. I'm going to vote in Illinois. I'm going to vote in Ohio. Well, I'm registered in Illinois, but I moved to Ohio, and Ohio is a swing state. Illinois is deep blue. I'm not going to vote in Illinois. I'm going to vote in Ohio without registering there. I mean, that happens all the time.
You're talking about the most ridiculous kinds of cases. People, you're talking about individual vote fraud. You're not talking about the kind of massive vote fraud that people are complaining about.
Because the Democrats are not interested in trying to get as many votes legitimately or not as possible?
How are you going to get that guy or woman who is leaving Illinois, does not say take me off the polls, and moves to Florida, moves to Ohio?
To be fair, that person could have an Illinois driver's license with an Illinois address.
You know, all it comes down to is it's very easy for the opposite political side to say that racial animus motivates the Trump's actions or the Secretary of State's that are Republicans' actions. And I guess when you hear an argument like that, we can get into the weeds on all these things that we can do. But if someone's predisposed to think that of a certain person or of a political party, there's really nothing. We're kind of like just talking at the air, because there's an ingrained belief there. And we all have them. We all have them about political parties and people, but it's not really a productive discussion in my mind about this point, because we're not going to convince each other. One side thinks the other is motivated by being racist, and the other side says that's not true. And that's really, I guess, what it really boils down to.
But you can't say you're for vote
integrity.
I am willing
to say that it is not. It turns out to be racial, because, as we know, there is a racial voting block, two racial voting blocks, African Americans and Latinx. So, if you're saying that the prejudice, that the people who are trying to screw a block of African Americans or Latinx because of politics, I could buy it. Oh, you're not doing it racially. You're not doing it for racial animus. You're doing it for political purpose.
It's the same reason Democrats want open borders.
Democrats don't want open borders. That's another canard. You know, talk about, you've used the word canard 8 or 10 times, and how about buying that
well,
one back?
Well, they certainly don't want a well-controlled, locked-down border. I mean, obviously not. I mean, we've even gotten into discussion.
How do you reconcile getting rid of ICE with not supporting open borders? Right. There, it's one and the same. ICE helps secure borders.
No, ICE doesn't help.
And you're about to explain to me something I already know. Customs and Border Patrol polices the borders. ICE deals with illegal immigrants who are in this country.
In the interior.
I understand.
Correct.
Yeah, no, so, I get it. I do understand that.
Okay, so like ICE isn't policing the border, so that really is a separate issue.
But again, would you agree that if someone wants to abolish ICE, aren't they making a decision for those that have broken the law because they want those people to get away with it? In other words, Kamala Harris really doesn't want any government agency going in and looking for 900,000 people to deport them. That's not in her best interest. It's not in the best interest of the Democratic Party. They want as many people as possible, and if there's confusion as to whether they can vote, they love it, because there'll be charges that they're being kept away.
I don't see how increasing the number of undocumented people who probably can't get a photo ID or get on a voter registration list is good for Democratic election results.
Why? Here's my point. Why can't someone who's here, they've come here illegally, there's been a judge in some way has said, you know, you didn't pass the criteria, you're going to be deported. Should those people have an ID? Should illegal immigrants have an ID?
I mean, in Illinois, we do have the temporary visitor driver's license, right? So that doesn't serve for driver's license purposes. It just allows someone to drive safely. And I'm all for that because, I mean, if you think about these rural areas, people are driving. Why not have them report, go through tests, go through screening, pay the fees to get an ID so they can drive and get insurance, auto insurance and as well.
But you told the story. When we come back, I want you to tell the story that you told everybody about your clients that put on a form, I'm not a citizen. And tell the audience, how many of those people were sent the voter's card. When we come back, you tell that story. It'll be an interesting one to stay tuned for. Back shortly. Bruce DuMont back. We are on the air, and let's go to Bonnie listening to us in Crown Point, Indiana. Bonnie, go ahead. Are you there? Hello, Bonnie. Are you there? Line two, Bonnie is not there. How about Roger in Austin, Texas on line three? Are you there?
Good evening, Bruce.
Nice to hear a voice. Go ahead. You're on the air. Bonnie, if you're still there, stay on the line. Go ahead, Roger.
You know, many of the voter poll roll maintenance issues and ID issues that are claimed to be suppression are commonplace in Europe and many mm-hmm. European countries that many liberals that complain about voter suppression mm-hmm. all admire.
Right.
Here in Texas, we had a Senate Bill 9 in our last session that I worked on, and it was an attempt to stop the vote harvesting that the gentleman talked about earlier. Mm-hmm. We have voter drives that go through a lot of old folks' homes, and they take mail-in ballots, and they take these people en masse to the polls, and then they go into the booth with them and make their selections. And we tried to rein that in by saying, well, it needs to be a relative or, you know, somebody doing it one-on-one here. And you should have seen how the opposition demonized this logical bill to tighten up these regulations, claiming, oh, it makes it hard to vote and it's going to put people in prison for making honest mistakes. And it's just with none of that. And they went after this thing because I think, honestly, there's a segment of political organization in our country that wants voters that can't name their two U.S. senators, that don't know the three branches of government, that will just come in and vote on a gut feeling or going along with their friends.
Roger, I agree with you, but let me ask the $64 question here. Do you think that is something that one party does more than another party, or is it something that one party will do in one part of the country and a different party will do it in another part of the country? What's your sense on that?
I can't speak to all over the country. I can speak to Texas and a couple of other states I spend a lot of time in.
Mm-hmm.
And I would say it's pretty universally Democrats that are trying to open up voting for people that don't know the candidates, don't know the issues, and they can kind of steer to vote the way they want them to. And they don't want those limitations of ID and voter roll cleaning because it makes it nice and sloppy, you know? Old Mayor Daley would be proud of all this.
Don Rose, do you agree with the question that I asked of Roger?
Well, you split this in two pieces. I was talking. Okay. He's talking about that the Democrats are trying to get people who don't know who the senator is and don't know who this is and don't know who that is. They has nothing to do with eligibility to vote.
Okay. Would you agree, Don, and I want to get your reaction as Roger, do you think one party over the other is more interested in having low-educated, less-educated, low-interest voters, which is how some of the Trump supporters were described in 2016. Do you think that one party
is interested in low-information voters?
Do you think that one party over the other is interested in having a much broader group of stupid voters?
It depends on where you are. I don't think it's necessarily one party over the other, but where we see the great big attempts to suppress voters, as the guy in Pennsylvania acknowledged it. Several years ago, they finally knocked him out. He said, we have just passed this law, which means the GOP wins.
Oh, yeah.
You remember?
Famous
case.
In the court case. Go ahead. Roger, back to you.
Yeah,
what's your answer to that question?
I think you have a situation where many voters are brought in just to be kind of, I call them robot voters, that are going to come in, they're going to vote automatically either for a party or they're going to vote based on the coercion tactics of somebody on a voter drive type mechanism. And you know, these suppression things that they label like voter ID, they always complain, oh, well, there's just not enough instances of corruption to justify it. But yet then they'll say, oh, we've got to stop that stuff in Florida and or Georgia, when most of those roles were accurate to be removed. But they found a few people that were on there mistakenly, and so, oh, let's throw the whole thing out.
I want to also say the political parties, even though they always say, let's get a turnout and let's find ways to get people to turn out, the last thing that a political party wants is a huge turnout. Mm-hmm. I mean, if there was 100% voting in the United States, the leaders of the Republican Party and the Democrats, they would be scared out of their wits, because the public might be doing something that they don't want and can't control. So I think that they have all of these rules and regulations that make it more difficult for people to vote. They cry, oh, we want more people to vote. In reality, it's a bunch of BS. They don't want people voting. And having something really simple where you go in and here's my photo ID, and this is me, and I'm going to vote, the more honest you make an election, I think the more likely you're going to have a huge turnout. And politicians don't want huge turnouts. Don, do you agree with that or not?
Not completely at all. I think there's areas where I'd love to see huge turnouts. I would love to see 100% turnout in Illinois.
Well, I know you would.
Right.
All right, Roger, we're going to move on. Let's go to Ray, listening to us in California. You're listening on the internet. Go ahead.
Hi, Bruce. Good to talk to you. Longtime listener, first time caller.
Thank you.
Two things I wanted to address. One was your talk on immigration earlier.
Yes. Yes.
And I don't know the gentleman's name, but one of your guests there was saying that there hadn't been any change in the last whatever many years to account for the sudden influx of immigrations. And two things I'd like to say. One, back in the 80s, I was a paratrooper sent down on the behalf of you people down to El Salvador, Honduras, and Guatemala.
Mm-hmm.
And those people, or at least the ones that were on the outs, were brutalized. And I see the seeds for the problems at that time. But more recently, you've got the, in Honduras, you've got the coup that was essentially facilitated, I wouldn't say ordered, but facilitated by our government in 2009, that threw out Zelaya, of which since then the UN has, I think it was the UN, has labeled Honduras the most dangerous country in the world. It's horrible there right now. Mm-hmm. All of that, that whole area has been going through a very severe drought for the last 5 years, to where they, entire crops are ruined, which is causing mass migration besides the political issues. They've got issues in Nicaragua that you may have seen last year, mass riots and things like that. Mm-hmm. So, yes, in fact, there are causes. Now, I don't have a solution for you, but the country that I swore to defend, nowhere in that did I think that we would be the country that is treating these people the way that we are now. And again, I don't have the solution, but I do say as a citizen that what we're doing right now ain't right. The last thing you guys were talking about, voting.
Can you elaborate on what part of the treatment that you are offended by? What part of the treatment are you talking about? Are you talking about the delays in adjudicating their cases? Are you talking about the treatment while they're waiting? What is it that you're upset about?
Well, both parties are essentially using this as a political football to knock the other one down with.
Absolutely.
Okay.
That's true.
And
sure.
So I am just disgusted with the Congress. And not just recently, I mean for quite a while, right? I'm an attorney. I used to practice in immigration. I don't now. But it's the system has been broken for quite some time. Now, more recently, the issue that I have is how we're detaining these children.
Mm-hmm.
And I've got a real problem with that. But anyway, I don't want to take up all your time. I know you have other callers. I just mm-hmm. wanted to do one last point. Is you guys mentioned, and I hear this a lot, that you need a license to drive a car. Why shouldn't you need an ID to vote?
Mm-hmm.
And my simple answer for that is because driving a car is not a constitutionally protected right. Voting is. I'm a big Second Amendment supporter. This is an argument that I make to a lot of my friends and colleagues and stuff, calling for gun control, which on its face, the idea of which I don't have a problem with, but doing it willy-nilly through legislative means I do, because it is a constitutional right. And you make a precedent when you chip away at these things by just legislative means to chip away at our other civil rights.
Okay. Point well taken. We've got callers, and we'll hear from them when we roll on. One more segment from Chicago. Back in Chicago,
yes.
And a couple of segments ago during the break, Kelly Fennell, who is an immigration lawyer, you were telling a story about your clients and how some of them have been solicited for the opportunity to vote.
I don't want to characterize being solicited for the opportunity to vote. I would characterize it as a training issue with the DMV.
And this is in Illinois.
Right. And several years ago. I haven't had this come up recently. Like, I'm talking about registrations from the 90s. So I have had a handful of clients, I would say maybe three, that did go to get a driver's license. They checked renew a driver's license. They checked the I am not a citizen box, but they were still registered to vote by the person at the DMV. They didn't want to register to vote. They didn't intend to. And then, going through the green card status, you have to, if they want to get a green card and remain in the United States and eventually become a citizen, you have to prove that they never said they were a citizen on purpose and that they never voted. That's
shocking.
Why I have a huge issue with motor voter registrations. I think it's a terrible idea.
So for the few people that you've encountered, you're one attorney, how many other attorneys out there are encountering the same thing where they have clients here illegally or on a visa or however, whatever's happening, who are getting the same thing and who are taking that documentation down and voting? I mean, they're not all as upstanding as your clients apparently have been, where they've decided not to do something that is not legal for them
There's
to do.
There's absolutely no evidence that shows large numbers of undocumented people are coming out in droves and, you know, rounding up each other in mass in front of the polls. And also, I mean, we have seen increased screening at the DMV, and actually now I have several clients who are entitled to a driver's license who aren't allowed to get one.
But what is the argument? Neither one of you has made it yet against common sense steps to make the voting process have higher integrity. You both said, oh, there's no evidence of widespread this or what. But what is the argument against common sense reforms to give the process more integrity?
What is the argument against being good? Of course, as you pose it, there is no argument against increasing it, but that's not what's happening.
And having a driver's license or a state ID is no indication of what your immigration status is in the state of Illinois. Yeah.
But
the fact of the matter, it's not.
Because the Democrats have
made
it such
that it isn't. I could be an asylum seeker in deportation proceedings, and if I have a work authorization, mm-hmm. I can get a driver's license in Illinois. So,
but aren't all those things, can they not be put on an ID?
Yes.
So if you are not a citizen, this gets back to the question whether you're going to the DMV, and this gets back to the Supreme Court this week. Again, this is a political issue. The president may lose the battle as to whether or not you can put a citizenship question on the census.
Even though it was on there for 60
but
years.
But I think the vast majority of people in America, that's a common sense thing. Am I missing that?
Except the law says persons. The law,
right.
The constitutional aspect of this says we're not counting citizens, we're counting persons.
Yeah.
The last time we had a citizenship question on it was in 1950, which was a time when there'd been a vast immigration because of World War II.
Right.
And Ted Kennedy.
Hmm?
And Ted Kennedy and the immigration so-called reform of the mid-1960s that opened the floodgates of what we now see as modern immigration. Don't forget that.
In 1965, I believe.
Yeah, Immigration Act of 1965 was the first immigration law.
Thank you, Counselor.
Yeah. Well, we all know that, I mean, the census numbers, you know, you award representation based on how many people are living in your area. It's supposed to be citizens. But why
is it supposed to be citizens? It's supposed to be persons. That's what it says. It does not say citizens. It says persons.
And what is the objection, though? The objection to having a question of how many citizens are in this country? What is the objection? I've heard objections like, well, it's vilifying people. People might not want to cooperate and come out of the shadows. All these arguments that sound suspiciously like the arguments when it comes to not requiring voter ID.
It's very, very simple. Whether you think it's a good thing or not, people who are in this country who are not citizens mm-hmm. fear one kind or another of harassment, or even, you know, if they are undocumented, they would fear being caught out. They fear that they're using this.
And if they're undocumented, here illegally, they should be called out. But that's I'm skipping ahead. I understand.
Those immigrants who are here illegally, are they going to fill out the census form?
A substantial number will not. And that holds it down. But by forcing the issue, and the reason, you know, he knows he's going to lose this case in the Supreme Court, as he's already lost it. But very, very conservative.
Well, the ruling was about not that it wasn't legal.
Right.
The ruling was not that he could do it. The rationale, which is ridiculous too, that was decided that way by now our swing vote,
John Roberts.
Justice, well, is that now we're looking at
not
about this. Think about this for a minute.
Not no, the law
think
says,
about this.
Though.
You have to judge the motivations of the administration when they're trying to enact a law
precedent.
Or create a law.
That's not new legal
they
precedent.
They said the rationale that the Trump administration put forward
forward, they put it back to the Trump administration.
Right.
And they're intending to try again, come up with something better. That was what John Roberts was intimating in his his statement, that you guys need to come up with a different rationale for wanting that census
because
question on there.
There's well
which
established
is ridiculous.
Supreme Court precedent that goes back to the Civil Rights era that says you can't have a law be discriminatory in purpose. That's well-established precedent.
But if something,
so you can't have... So the administration, God forbid, they come up with an explanation.
Trying
that's
to figure
not
out how many illegal immigrants we have in this country is discriminatory?
Yes, that's what they're saying.
No, I'm asking you.
No, under the Supreme Court would probably not find that that's discriminatory.
On that note, we have solved absolutely nothing this evening.
Nope.
Hi, I'm Ryan Sandberg. And I want to tell you about Miracle, the musical.
That's it?
That was a hard close.
Yeah.
Very hard close. Right there.
Well, we got some good callers, yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.